Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen. One of the riffs I do with the confirmation students is comparing the three Johns: the Gospel of John, the Revelation of John, and the letters of John. In the first, particular points are emphasized by affirming, as we read today, I am. I am the bread of life, the light of the world, the good shepherd, the true vine. In the book of Revelation, particular points are emphasized with bizarre and, more importantly, memorable imagery. For example, Christ is the light that lights the city of God, and he is as well a multi-horned, multi-eyed, slain lamb that is also a lion. And there is found by the water of life a tree with leaves to heal the nation. And then there's the letter of John. The letters of John makes its point through repetition. It makes its point through staccato snarl, sentences squished together and snagging upon the soul of the reader. It repeats points again and again with slightly different jabs and hooks and punches until it knocks out the audience. If you haven't heard me yet, here it is for a fourth time. It wears you down with repetition, going after you again and again with wrestler's prowess, holding on to you heavily and hoping to grapple and grab onto the listener's whole person and pulling you down to the mat. Today, if you prune, separate out, and poke at the messy message found in the fourth chapter of the first letter of John, you come up with this fairly straightforward message. Love one another. Love one another because it reveals God. Love one another because it connects us to God. Love one another because of Christ's love. And love one another because God first love us. Let us pray. Lord God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord God, may the preacher decrease that you might increase. Amen. Love one another. Agape in the Greek. Agape one another. Love one another in an active way. This isn't sentimental or internal stuff. It's the kind of love you can do whether or not you like the other person. Love one another in a sacrificial way. Love like Christ loved us all the way. Love while running on empty. Love out of your weakness. Love so that it overflows. Think of sort of a parental love that after 3 hours of the child screaming and you being unable to tuck the kid in, you still keep going, the parents do. That kind of love, a sacrificial love, even with bags under your eyes. Love one another in a way motivated by God. There are other compasses that can point us to active, sacrificial love. But the one that motivates us Christians has both its essence and its origin in the God revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Love one another because it reveals God. When we love in active, sacrificial, godly ways, we often have aha moments when we glimpse God. There's a long tradition of Christian saints having aha moments, moments of glimpsing God while loving in an agape kind of way. It said Francis of Assisi knelt down and kissed a leper, and he realized he had in fact kissed Christ. Similarly, the mythical Saint Christopher took a small child upon his back in order to ferry him across a deep river. And halfway through, he recognized that the child was the Christ child, was Jesus. And his strength gave out, and he was pressed down into the waters and rose up again, a baptized man. Or think of Luther. Luther, too, had an aha moment that continues to shape how Lutherans talk about the connection between God and societal roles. While changing his son's diaper, Luther realized that act of service was just as holy, that act of serving God by serving neighbor was just as holy as his entire time in the monastery. Or think about that hard, but especially in these times, needed task of listening to sisters and brothers with whom we disagree. In doing so, we might see the face of God. After all, upon the cross, Christ seemed ungodly too, just some partisan hack of the other side, just as those holding opposite opinions to us so often look. And in so doing, we see the face of God. Yes, we glimpse God when we love one another. Love one another because it connects us to God. When we love one another, that aha moment can become something more. It's not just a one-time event. It's like birth. It takes a while. It's motherly embrace that doesn't just happen once. It's becoming family. It's knowing from experience, knowing it in your bones and in your soul. It's abiding. That is living, dwelling, being in it, moving into the presence of God, being held to God's breast as a child upon a mother's breast. Think about it. Practicing love and becoming connected to the one who loves. Think about, as well, anything that you have practiced. Not every moment, for example, not every moment on the baseball field is home runs and Gatorade. It's calluses, blisters and sore muscles, time taken out of your day, and commitments. And yet, in doing that, you become something else, you become part of a team, you become part of something else, you become something else, you become a ball player. And it's glorious. So too, loving one another shapes us, sticks with us, becomes part of us. We become part of it, and we are reborn. Yes, we are changed and connected to God by loving one another. Love one another because of Christ's love. Christ's command to love one another is told when he demonstrates that very thing. He kneels and holds on to his disciples' feet, washing the dirt and dust from those feet as he says, "Love one another." Those same feet trampling along, following after him, to worried parents, outcast women, blind men, and faithful centurions. Serving them with feet and hands, loving in a sacrificial way, following his Father's calling upon his life. Loving to the end. Loving with arms outstretched upon the cross, outstretched for you and for me. Loving too, beyond then, opening the tomb so that he might abide with us, bearing and birthing us out into the world, meeting us in our acts of service and love, that we might entertain him unaware that we are doing so. Yes, Christ Jesus loves us so deeply, and we can show that love by loving one another. Love one another because God first loved us. Now it's reasonable, truly it is, it's reasonable to fear loving others, loving one another in an agape way. There's a lot to lose when you do that, potentially. For that matter, it's risky to love in that kind of way. The tension between emotion and action might be too much. The hard ongoing outpouring of love drains you and does nothing to the recalcitrant heart of the beloved. They never love you back, and you grow bitter. The sacrifices might be too much. You give and you give and never see the results of your labor. You plant and another reaps. And perhaps even the actions, these loving actions, these agape actions, can become ends in and of themselves. The compass is lost. The north star of God is obscured. But beloved, it's worth the risk. It's worth losing too much love, because the loving has already been done. God first loved us, and so we respond by loving our neighbor in need and loving our sisters and our brothers in Christ. God acted first. God loved first. The entirety of the Acts of the Apostles can be read as God acting first and the church catching up. God acted first, God welcomed first, God loved first. Pentecost fire showed God's love for Gentiles. Then the early Christians had to spend time and treasure on them as well. They made the Gentiles table servers. But God acted first and loved first and made them powerful preachers of the gospel. And as we see in today's lesson from Acts, God is already acting with this rich and powerful Ethiopian eunuch before Philip can do a single thing. Philip has to catch up and love this one who God has already loved. And that right there, that's the story. God loved us when yet sinners and oppressed, sending his Son. God loved us when we clung to an unjust society by sending the prophet. God loved us when we blamed each other for our suffering by sending the wise ones who wrote the books of Job and Ecclesiastes and short-circuited that way of thinking and blame. God loved us when we were in slavery and crying out with the deepest need, by bringing us through the sea and on to freedom. God loved us, this is the cool one, this is the amazing one that should blow your mind forever. God loved us before we even existed, calling forth over the deep. Spirit calling all things seen and unseen into being, that they might be loved. Yes, God first loved us, let us love one another. Love one another because it reveals God and connects us to God. Love one another because God in Christ Jesus first loved us. Love one another. Amen and hallelujah.